Keith Boyd to talk about massive online learning systems and why you should take that into account when creating a global content strategy. Keith.
I've always wanted to run on one of these stages, you know, TED style, right? It looks kind of cool. So thank you very much, Jack. It's a pleasure to be with everybody today for another LavaCon. I was just thinking back, when was the first time that I attended LavaCon? It was actually in Hawaii, and I think it was 2005, so it was in Honolulu. And I can tell you that both Jack and I had a lot more hair back then. So it's really great to be with you guys today. My background, although I'm going to be talking about massively open online courses, my background is technical communications. I've worked in TechCom for the majority of my career. I spent the first 15 years of my career at Microsoft as a programming writer, and then later as a group manager, responsible for technical documentation for the entirety of the Windows division, and then later for the Cloud and Enterprise division. So pretty huge span of control, lots of different content. The last time that I actually spoke here at LavaCon was to talk about some of the things that we'd done in our technical documentation for Windows 8. And I just want to say on behalf of the entire company, I'm sorry for Windows 8. So when I reached out to Jack to talk about this really cool idea that I had for a talk, I was really surprised and delighted when he said, yeah, I'd love for you to come and talk about cows and Vulcans. And I'm like, okay, cool. Hey, that's great. I got like free reign here. But no, in reality, MOOCs and SPOCs have nothing to do with cows or Vulcans. MOOC is an acronym for Massive Open Online Class. And as opposed to SPOC, which is a self-paced, or it's always great when you have like acronym collision in your own industry, small private online class. So the difference between the two is one is obviously much bigger than the other. Both of them are open generally for people to enroll in. You can see some of the other hallmarks on the screen. When you enroll in a massively open online class, you have an expectation that there's a forum where you can go to ask questions or interact with other students, faculty members, and TAs. And on the SPOC side, yeah, you're less likely to do that. You're not going to be participating in a course as a member of a cohort. You're probably not going to have as much interaction with an instructor. But both of these are sort of emergent modalities right now for online learning, and they're kind of turning things on their ear when it comes to academia and potentially within your own content strategy. So back in 2012, the New York Times, you can see a URL there, declared it the year of the MOOC. 2012, you can see that quote, traditional online courses charge tuition, carry credit, and limit enrollment to a few dozen to ensure interaction with instructors. The MOOC, on the other hand, is usually free, creditless, and, well, massive. So this was like the big coming out party for these MOOCs. Like anybody in the world can enroll in a course and get knowledge from like amazing professors from Harvard or MIT or from overseas, you know, at Delft in the EU or Zhejiang University in China. So it turns out that the hype at that point in time was just a little bit overblown. If you fast forward to 2017, what you're going to see, oh, come on, my animation, don't let me down now. Ah, killing me. All right, the animation would show you that the trend has actually been a little bit different. So the trend has been that there's actually been an explosion of these types of courses, but instead of them being massive, there's been this proliferation of smaller courses, like we talked about, that are self-paced. In fact, the rise of organizations like Pluralsight, Lynda.com, now part of Microsoft, or LinkedIn Learning, that's been sort of the way. There's been sort of a rise of these smaller self-paced courses that people could enroll in to really learn just about anything. And in fact, there's another trend that sort of is opposed to what the New York Times had to say, which is that a lot of these now actually bear academic credit. You can log in, you can actually take a MOOC and actually get academic credit from a leading academic institution. Now, just quickly, show of hands, has anybody in the room been through a MOOC before? That's awesome. So I'd say maybe about 25% of the people in the room. That's fantastic. For the rest of you, I highly encourage you to go out. And you're going to learn just about how to do that in just a minute. So to give you an idea, too, about the rise of MOOCs over time, you can see that graph on the right-hand side of the screen. Back in 2012, the New York Times got very excited about MOOCs. There were just a handful of them in the world, like, you know, maybe 100 of them. Now, granted, they were from some of the most reputable and amazing professors in the world, but there just weren't that many of them in the market. So flash forward to today, and you've got almost 7,000 courses available for people to enroll in. from 700 leading universities all over the world and 58 million students. So the subset of folks in this room, you're part of that composite 58 million number. The leading players, at least by the number of people that enroll in these courses, are there in the lower box. So the purplish box there is Coursera. They have 26 million registered users. The next box is edX, which was founded by MIT and Harvard, sitting at about 13. And the rest is just sort of a distribution curve, you know, that's less impressive, but still you can see that there's some really huge numbers of people that are actually taking advantage of this modality. All right, here goes nothing. My next slide has an animation. If it doesn't work, I work at Microsoft, so I can't blame anybody. So how does this new modality fit into your content strategy? That's really why you guys are all here, right? To think about how you can have a cutting-edge content strategy. Well, what I see is that if you think about your content and sort of this four-quadrant model, where that x-axis relates to the depth of the content, so from just-in-time learning, just-in-time help, right? I have a question I needed to be answered. This is the stuff that Suri might be able to help you with. All the way through on to mastery, like I've absolutely mastered the product or service. And then that other axis, the y-axis, is I'm just kind of curious. I might have just discovered your product. I think that this might be interesting, might solve a problem within my organization. All the way down to I'm a committed user. I've already made the purchase. I'm in your ecosystem. I am ready to actually get the most value from this product that I've just purchased. The way that I see things is that upper quadrant, probably not a surprise, it's a great place for marketing communications to play. You obviously want people to make that purchase, to enter into your ecosystem, make that bet in your product or service. Below that, generally, is the realm for technical communications. I need to know how to do this thing, how to fulfill that promise of value that you made to me when I bought this product or service, so I expect that I'm going to have terrific technical communications to help me get through that. We're going to talk a little bit in just a minute about this quadrant, so badges. Badges is just a digital representation of an accomplishment that you have. And I've got this kind of in my model because if you think about, I'm kind of still exploring, but I might really be interested in learning more about this product or service. Badges, and I'll show you a really specific example of how Salesforce uses this particularly effectively, are a great way to kind of pull people more deeply into your ecosystem. And then finally, in that quadrant where you have committed users that really are seeking mastery, MOOCs and SPOCs can play a really significant role in pulling people along through that journey from just-in-time learning to being extraordinarily committed to your product or service. So some of the reasons to consider having MOOCs as part of your content strategy. Well, the first box there is pretty clear. If you give something to somebody that they consider to be very high value, something that they would normally have to pay for, and generally MOOCs cost anywhere from free to, you know, upwards of multiple hundreds of dollars. If you can incorporate that as a significant value add as part of your content portfolio, people are going to perceive significant value. The next box, MOOCs just encourage deeper learning. The very nature of the modality pulls people in. It's a combination of online video, assessments, HTML elements. You can use all kinds of different ways to actually make the learning experience very rich. So its very nature goes well beyond what a technical document can do, pulls people in, and encourages them to learn in a much deeper way than they might simply by reading through documentation or by getting a clever answer from Suri or Cortana. If you do them the right way, they can inspire and motivate your users to stick with you and to learn more about your product and service and potentially even unlock some of the more complicated features or things that otherwise might be deeper under the hood than that surface level view. And then finally, and that's why I included this graph here, MOOCs allow you to engage learners, and all of the people that are reading through documentation are trying to learn something in lots of different ways. You can kind of see these different learning styles. Generally, when we think about what we do with technical communications, it's about linguistic and verbal, but when you think about all the other different ways that you can actually encourage people to learn, the MOOC modality, by the very nature of its interactivity, allows you to key in on all those different learning styles and actually make it a much richer experience for the learner so that they feel much more confidence with your product or service. They are learning the way that they need to learn, not just that one modality of reading documentation or having Suri or Cortana or Alexa read it back to you. So just to kind of give you a survey of who's out there and who's doing what, some of these companies hopefully you've heard of. Udacity is sort of a very interesting company. They were founded by a guy named Sebastian Thrun, who used to be responsible for Google's xLabs. They're the guys that are actually building the self-driving car right now. They had this vision years ago that they could actually train engineers with nothing more than this online learning modality, and that they could actually lead to getting employment at places like Google. And as it turns out, a lot of people that have earned these nano degrees from Udacity are actually working at Google, and they might even be working at some of your places of employment. It's kind of an amazing way to go and brush up on your technical skills. They've got courses on a wide range of different technical areas, and people that actually achieve those nano degrees are earning a resume-worthy credential that's going to help them achieve their career aspirations. I mentioned edX earlier. edX was founded by MIT and Harvard, and it's sort of by their extension schools, and it's a great place to go and learn academic subjects. It happens to be Microsoft's partner in this arena. Coursera, I think, is probably ubiquitous in the industry. We already talked about the fact that they've got the most users. Udemy is sort of a courseware marketplace. Any of you today, as technical communication specialists, content strategists, marketing specialists, could go home, film a course, put it up on Udemy, start charging whatever you think is fair, and the crowd will decide what's successful and what isn't. But you can actually start your own business right now using Udemy. There is nothing to prevent you from building a course and sharing your knowledge. Lynda.com, part of LinkedIn, now part of Microsoft, great on-demand library covering a lot of different areas from creativity to technical skills. Likewise, Pluralsight, very similar. Pluralsight did something very interesting, though. At their most recent conference, they released a product that they call Iris. Iris is designed to put traditional certification out of business. The whole idea is that you can come to Pluralsight, they will assess your skill in any domain, tell you how you rank, and then tell you what you need to do to get that ranking up. And then, de facto, once you get it to that maximum ranking, certify you on any skill. That's their vision. Fascinating. Really going to be interesting to watch that. And then finally, I put Open Classrooms on there because it's a really interesting firm. I met their CEO in Redmond just a couple of weeks ago. They have online, fully accredited bachelor's degrees in just about, I think, 30 subjects now, $4,000 each. $4,000. And the thing that's really remarkable is that all of their curriculum is designed to be consumed in 12 months. So if you'd like to go back and get your bachelor's in 12 months, go check out Open Classrooms. So those are all commercial. The question you might have is, so can I do this? How do I make this part of my content strategy? The answer is emphatically yes. And there are lots of different ways that you can actually incorporate MOOCs or self-paced online learning into your content strategy. You can see those organizations there on the left, edX, Moodle, Course Sites, Udemy, Versal. These are just some of the commercial platforms that are available for you to either deploy in a hosted way on your own web properties, or you can actually work with them directly to get courses that you can then give away for free to users, or potentially even charge users for if you want to try to make back some of your investment. So the options that you have, you can build your own MOOC, working with one of these third-party platforms or with an open source platform like OpenEdX. You can build it yourself and then have it on a hosted platform, a third-party platform, or you can work with a third party and basically outsource the development of the MOOC. If you do that, just to kind of put a ballpark figure on that, that could be relatively expensive. Just like there's a lot of expertise in this room, the people that do this professionally charge anywhere from about $10,000 to $50,000, depending on the complexity of the course. So if you want to acquire, you certainly can do it, but do make sure that you've got budget to do that. I mentioned badging earlier, and it really just gave me an excuse to include a reference to Treasurer of the Sierra Madre. Do we need any stinking badges? My opinion is that you should consider badges as part of your content strategy. Now, a badge is really just a digital representation of some kind of accomplishment, a way to share something. You've probably seen these in games that you might have played on your phone. Maybe your kids have played Xbox or PlayStation, gotten a stamp or a badge that they can share with their friends. The thing that's cool about these, though, is that they really do drive affinity. They provide a way to recognize skills that people have developed on your platform or service. And maybe the most important is they give a really natural way for people to socially amplify whatever it is that they accomplished. Now, I'll show an example of that in just one second. But what you can think of is if you do badging for your product or service, it's like free publicity. Because if you give me a badge that says, hey, congratulations, Keith, you completed this training module, you consumed all this documentation, you passed this short online quiz, and I decide to share it with my network on LinkedIn, that's just free love for you. And if I tweet it and I happen to put it on Facebook too, then it's times three. It's pretty easy to do. The scenario here, and like I mentioned, is there anybody from Salesforce here? Anybody? Awesome. Well done. Our friends at Salesforce, who actually just entered into an alliance with Google today, thank you. Our friends at Salesforce have a great program called Trailhead. Do you happen to work on Trailhead? Fantastic. So Trailhead's terrific. If you guys want to see just an outstanding example of how you can use all of the different techniques of massively open online courses, self-paced online courses, and traditional technical content, I recommend checking out Salesforce Trailhead. So this is the entry page for Trailhead. And you can see there's a few options up there on the screen. Relatively hard to read on this, I'm sorry. But what you can see there is trails and modules, badges. If you click on Trails on their opening page, you get a couple of different options. There's lots of different options, lots of different trails that you can go through. And this is like a metaphor that actually holds through throughout the entire site. The whole idea is you start somewhere, you end somewhere, and that end point is somewhere around building a skill that will make you more productive in your role. And if you complete that trail, and you're logged in on Salesforce's site, they give you a badge to show for it. And that actually works for them in a couple of different ways. One, you can they get the lift from that social interaction that you might have with Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, et cetera. And two, they also develop a relationship with you because it allows them to do relationship marketing. In order to go claim that badge, they need to know who you are. So suddenly you've got a relationship. Your sales team is actually able to correspond with that customer who actually took the time to do something of meaning and receive something of value from your organization for free. So if you just go look on LinkedIn right now, you can find thousands of people who have added their Salesforce Trailhead badges to their LinkedIn profile, actually signaling to the world their affinity for your product or service. It's really remarkably powerful and really remarkably simple. So how can you do badging? There are many different purveyors of this technology in the marketplace. I've highlighted three here for your consideration. The first is from Pearson, so Pearson Acclaim, which is one of the leading platforms. One of the neat things about their badging platform is that if you claim a badge, they also can then show you locally relevant jobs for people that have actually earned that badge. So if it happens to be Salesforce, they might be able to show you local consultant gigs in your environment. If it happens to be from Microsoft, they might say, hey, this job requires a Microsoft certified professional. So that's one option. Another is an organization called Credly. They've got a lot of Fortune 500 customers. They both do internal badging, so these might be badges that stay with the corporation if you leave it, but they can actually indicate that you've gained a skill and put that on your internal resume or portfolio, but also externally as well. And then finally, Badger is an open source platform that you can deploy. Anybody can deploy it, but there are also people that do hosted Badger deployments on your behalf. So I would highly encourage you, if you go down this path of considering massively open online courses or self-paced online courses as part of your strategy, make sure that when somebody completes it, you offer them the ability to have that badge so that they can share that accomplishment and socially amplify that achievement to help your business. With that, thank you very much.